Hey everybody, Avery Bradshaw from the Kentucky Music Hall of Fame, and I hope you all are doing well out there, and we appreciate you tuning in today. We've got a really special unveiling today. I wanted to take a little bit of time to tell you about some of the new exhibits that we have coming up at the Hall of Fame. You can find a full list of them on our website, but we're going to be featuring all kinds of different Kentucky artists from all kinds of genres as well. And so this is the first of many installments that we're going to have over the next several weeks. And today's installment is going to be Mr. Darrell Scott, and we're so excited to have him here today. And I think he's got a lot in store for you, and we appreciate you coming in. And so, without further ado, we're going to go ahead and unveil this exhibit behind me, and then I'm going to invite Mr. Darrell to come up here and talk to you for a few minutes. So let's see if I can do this. So this is the new exhibit, and we want to go ahead and invite Mr. Darrell to come up and pose for a couple of pictures, and then he's going to talk to you.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it looks great. It looks great. Do you want me to stand here for a little bit?
That'd be good.
Okay. Make sure you get that hummingbird guitar in there.
I got it.
Yeah. Great, great. Well, thanks for having me, Avery.
Yes.
And I've been to the museum, I don't know if it's 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I popped in because I was driving, I think, to New York State for a gig by myself, and I thought, now's the time. So I pulled off and came through here. This is a great museum.
Thank
it made
you.
Me very proud to be a Kentucky musician and that y'all had done what you've done here. As a museum, and I got a little bit of a story. I know for my dad, for a lot of folks, the Renfro Valley, the Barn Dance, and that radio program was big. It was like right up there with, you know, the Wheeling Jamboree that you get out of West Virginia, and of course WSM, the Grand Ole Opry, and all that. And to a Kentucky boy, the Renfro Valley was about as big as it could get. So my dad was such a boy as that. So I must have been about 7 years old. We pulled into the back of the Renfro Valley, and I don't know if it was my Uncle Ran or my dad, somebody talked to whoever was in charge of the show and said, hey, we've got a family here from Kentucky that wants to play in tonight's show. You know, literally showing up to the back door, literally. And so they talk us onto the show.
Yeah.
And I'm about 7 years old, and my brothers are in the band, you know, they would have been 10 and 13. And then my dad, he would have been somewhere in his early 30s, I guess. And anyway, so we're about to go on, and we're standing back there, you know, at that back door. And my dad was so nervous because this may as well have been the Grand Ole Opry to him, right? And so I'd never seen him do this before nor since, but he got so nervous that his hands would just shake involuntarily, and his legs and his stomach and his cheeks and everything, and it was really clear he couldn't go on. So we went back to the motel room and never even played the Renfro Valley. But the following year, I think it was, you know, was in my dad's craw that, you know, he needs to conquer that. He needs to get on that stage. So we came back the following summer and did the same thing again, asked if we could play. And they put us on, and that time we did play it. That would have been 67, 68, somewhere around in there. So, and of course I heard all the stories growing up. My family's been from Kentucky past 200 years, you know. Harlan County, coal mining on both sides of my family. And then coming to Knox County, you know, for tobacco farming and all that. So that's where my roots come from. And I'm very pleased to have family here from Nebraska, and also my cousins here in the Kentucky area who came out here today to this. And so my Kentucky roots go way deep. I grew up in a music family, my dad, all my brothers. You know, like I say, if we're standing in the back door of the Renfro Valley Barn Dance, you know, at my age, 7 years old, believe me, we played and did all kinds of music. So the Kentucky roots run very, very deep. And it's funny that we do this as human beings. It seems like sometimes you try to get away from where you came from a little bit. You might try to move away. You might try to change your religion that you grew up in, or the political this or that. That's part of growing up, and you go find your own way. So I can remember a time where, you know, I wanted to downplay my Kentucky thing, even though with my parents and my brothers, it's pretty hard to do that. But I found a great bounty when that chase was over somewhere, probably in my 30s somewhere, where I started really, and I was always proud of being from Kentucky, but it's like I turned a corner that, no, wait a minute, Kentucky is very important to what I do. It's my family, it's the music, it's the land, it's the hard working, and so I started embracing it, and it started showing up in my music. So, like I remember the song You'll Never Leave Harlan Alive came about. I wasn't trying to write a song. I was in Harlan County looking to see what happened to a great-grandfather of mine who exited family history. And so when they moved from Harlan County to Knox County, I think this guy might have come to the grandfather, great-grandfather, but then soon after he disappeared. I don't know why. No one was ever talk about him again. All I knew about him was that he was a musician. Well, that's got my attention like right away. And he played banjo, and he taught music. So I was always interested in that guy, even though in the family we kind of didn't have any information, because Granny had sort of set it up a long time ago never to mention his name. At least that's the way it fell down into my family. So I went looking to see what happened to him. So I went to Harlan County with my dad, and we went to two spots. I went into the library there where they had old records and history. So I was trying to look for his name and try to find where he died. Did he remarry? Did he whatever? And I'm not a very good researcher, but I was there to try to figure it out. And then the next thing we did was went over to Willems Creek, where the family was from, more specifically in Harlan County, to see if we could read some gravestones. And so I was in that graveyard with my dad, turning over old stones and trying to read, you know, to see if there's a name. And we came up with nothing, but about a week later is when that song popped out. So I didn't go there writing the song. I went there to find out what happened to great-grandfather. And but I was very observant that whole time, and while I was in the holler, I could see, you know, that you wouldn't be able to see the sun until it reached, you know, about right there. And then the sun would go away when it reached about right there. So that image stayed with me. So that showed up in the song, the sun comes up about 10 in the morning, and the sun goes down about 3 every day, or in the day. And so those were kind of the images that I took back with me. Now, again, I wasn't trying to write a song, but they showed up in the song the following, about a week later. And so let me play that song for you. Hey, by the way, Avery, where is the camera?
Right there.
It's right there? That's a camera?
Yeah. I'm going to set this right. <Very good. laughs> So you can wave to everybody. Right,
yeah. There. Right. Looks good in there.
And I'm going to reposition this so they can see you.
Yeah. Let's see. Okay. So I thought I'd do this song. In the exhibit here, and again, I have been here. I was here 2 or 3 years ago, and very impressed by this museum, and that it's Kentucky forward. Of course, it would be. They've done a really good job. The history here, starting mostly with the Renfro Valley, which we're basically on their grounds, and so when somehow or another you got asked, or what's that? Oh, thank you. About this exhibit, I knew I wanted it to be Kentucky-centric, of course, so I've written a lot about Kentucky or family, and so I chose two songs that's got my lyric up there, You'll Never Leave Harlan Alive, which I'll do for you, and I was talking about. And then another one called the Hummingbird. And the Hummingbird is a Gibson Hummingbird. It was kind of the top-notch decorative Gibson that they made. And my dad always wanted one, and he never got one. And so I'd say maybe in the last 10 or 5 to 10 years of his life, I got him that Gibson Hummingbird right there. And I found it up in Boston. There's a great store up there called Music Emporium, and they have great old vintage instruments. And I went in there and played that, and it was like, this is the best Hummingbird I've ever played. And I bought it, and I gave it to my dad through my son, about 6 or 7 at the time, at a show that I knew my dad was going to be in the audience. And I called him up, and then Gabe, my son, gave it to him, and that's him right there looking at it for the first time on stage. He didn't know about it, so we got that shot in there. This shot right here is when we lived in northern Indiana. I'm probably 6 or 7 right there. The reason I know I recognize the curtains, that's Indiana. The other thing is I'm on snare drum. But Dad always had us start on snare drum because he thought before you learn any kind of chords or harmony, you need to have rhythm. So my dad's school of music, so to speak, was to start off a kid on snare drum, and that's me, 6 or 7 years old, on the snare. So I always played bass, so I know this is really early because I'm still playing a snare. The other thing I noticed in it, my cousins will appreciate that, you'll see somebody's body behind me. Well, that's Dale. So Dale wanted to play the drums, but Dad had me sitting for some reason for this picture. And there's Denny, my brother, and there's Dad. And so Dale's hiding back there. You'll see him. Here's a picture of my dad playing the Hummingbird guitar. And that's me on banjo. We're somewhere, I think, Johnson City, Tennessee, or something like that, probably the down home. And Uncle Harry took that picture of Anna and Harry. My son Gabe took that picture right there with that nice Gretsch guitar. And that's from, my son is a photographer, and so he's done a lot of photo stuff on the last 2 albums I've done. And then there's the Hummingbird guitar, the very one. And I'll talk about that in a second. But I'll do this song, You'll Never Leave Harlan Alive, on this. In the deep, dark hills of eastern Kentucky, see, that's the place where I trace my bloodline. And it's there I read on a hillside gravestone, said, you will never leave Harlan alive. Well, my granddad's dad walked down Catterin's Mountain, and he asked Tilly Hilton to be his bride. Said, won't you walk with me out of the mouth of this holler? Comes up about 10 in the morning, and the sun goes down about 3 every day, and you fill your cup with whatever bitter brew you're drinking, and you spend your life just thinking of how to get away. No one till the man from the northeast arrived. He was waving them $100 bills. He said, I'll pay you for your minerals. Oh, but he never left Harlan alive. Sold out cheap. they moved out west to Pineville to a farm where big rich land river winds. Yeah, and I bet they danced them a chick and they laughed and sang a new song. Who said we'd never leave Harland selling. And old granddad knew what he'd do to survive. Well, they went and dug for Harland coal and sent the money back to Granny. Oh, but he never left Harland alive. Where the sun comes up about 10 in the morning and the sun goes down about 3 every day, and you fill your cup, go on and fill it up with whatever bitter brew you're drinking, and you spend your life digging coal from the bottom of your grave, your the deep dark hills of eastern Kentucky. See, that's the place where I trace my bloodline. And it's there I read on a hillside gravestone, said you will never leave Harland alive. That into great. So another thing we're celebrating this very day is this new record of mine came out today, called Heroso, and just happened to be the same day, and so we're really happy to have that out starting today. Heroso, it's kind of a live recording is what it is, and Heroso is a little town in Colorado. You're almost in New Mexico when you get there. And anyway, that came out today, and a very kind of sweet, intimate kind of record that is. So I wanted to let you know about that. So So I maintain that if you have Kentucky parents and you live in Beverly Hills, you may as well be in Kentucky. So just outside of your house might be something else, like Beverly Hills or California, but I'm telling you, inside the house, you're with Kentucky family. So we moved around a lot, northern Indiana, my dad worked steel mills, Detroit, my dad worked car factories, like a lot of folks from the south went up to those industrial spots to work. And then I don't know where it came from, but then next thing you know, we moved to California. And again, I think a couple things happen. When you move around that much, you become even a tighter group, because you kind of have to, because you're the new kid in school in Indiana, Kentucky, Tennessee, Michigan, California. We moved around a lot. I remember counting, you know, in a 2-year period, I think I'd been to 4 or 5 schools in that period. And so you learn, you know, I learned to observe and be quiet and watch like on the playground or this or that, or in a new church or whatever it might be, which helped out my songwriting. Because to me, songwriting is observing. Number one, you're an observer. The other thing is how strong the Kentucky thing was, even if you lived in California. Because I guarantee you, if you knew my mom and dad, you'd know they have nothing but Kentucky to come out of and come from, no matter where they live. So the Kentucky thing has always been there, and the storytelling, that's part of a Kentucky or Appalachian kind of, by the way, it's Appalachian to me. I'm from Appalachia, and I never even knew we were supposed to call it Appalachia, you see. But see, I don't care, because that's how we pronounce it, and I'm not going to change it now. And that's some of that Kentucky stubbornness, that's some of that Appalachian stuff. That's just how it works. And you don't have to apologize for how you pronounce something or mispronounce something, right? So that kind of pride and fierce independence stayed with me. And I try to bring that into my music, believe it or not, along with the storytelling that's part of a Kentucky tradition too. So all that I picked up on one way or another, coming from the family that I did and coming from Kentucky. So what I'm going to finish with right here is another song lyric that I wrote out up there for the exhibit thing. And it's called The Hummingbird. Oh, and it's on this new record of Horoso. I'd forgotten that. Yeah, that's right. It's on this new record of Horoso. And it's a story about, what turned out to be that guitar, which there it is when Gabriel gave it to Dad. And I'll sing this thing for you, and then we'll kind of close with that. He always wanted a Hummingbird guitar, Dad did, because they're beautiful. Look at it. It's like those Cadillacs from the 50s or 60s with all the chrome and all the curves and all that stuff. Well, the Hummingbird was that equivalent to a boy who couldn't afford one, and my dad could not afford a Hummingbird. It's the top, probably the top priced thing that Gibson made. It didn't mean he didn't want one, but he didn't get one. What he had right is down here. That's the Gibson he had. And someone who knows a lot more about Gibsons and guitar history would know what that is. I kind of don't know, but I know it's not a Hummingbird. And so the story is, and it's a true story, I was the leader of the pack. I took that guitar down to the swamp. This was northern Indiana. The swamp wasn't too far away, 3-minute walk, and you'd be there. And I'll tell the story in the song. It does it a better job. But and I always thought, no, I definitely did that, but why did I do that as a kid? And then my older brothers told me that Dad had taken that guitar, and he was kind of like, I guess I'm over with music, you know, may as well throw it out in the garage, and he did. So he put that guitar in the garage in northern Indiana through the winter, and it was just a mess by the next year. He just had it up on a nail. And so I think what happened is we saw that junked out guitar. This is before that. But by the time he sort of got frustrated with it, we took it down to the swamp, and it shows up in this song. His frustration with either music or something showed up in his dreams about a guitar. And so when I found that guitar up in Boston on the road and just popped into a great shop, and there's the best Hummingbird I've ever heard, I knew what I'd do, which was buy it for him and give it to him. And that's what we did. And so that's in there in the case too. So those are the two main things I brought into that case. Some pictures and those two songs, basically that story. So I'm going to finish up with this. It's called The Hummingbird. One other thing to say about this song, the very first thing I ever learned to play on a guitar was what I'm going to play is the intro to this thing. And so when I came about writing this song, I thought, I'll put that thing. First thing I ever learned on a guitar, probably 5 years old or whatever I was, and that's what starts this off. And thank you, Avery, and the Kentucky Music Hall of Fame for you know, for asking me to come and be a part of this museum and this history here that's so rich in Kentucky for music. Some of my favorite folks are from Kentucky. Songwriter Tom T. Hall is pretty hard to beat him. I'm seeing a picture over there of Merle Travis. That's pretty hard to beat. You've got Ricky Skaggs, you know. Who plays better than Ricky? Who sings better tenor than Ricky? And so, you know, some of the best have come from this state. And I'm Sam Bush, you know. So I'm very proud of what Kentucky has produced for music and writing. You have Wendell Berry in, on another side of the spectrum, perhaps, but absolutely Kentucky writings. So I'm proud to be a part of that tradition. And I'm going to play this song called The Hummingbird. Farm boy from Kentucky Hills learned to play guitar for his back porch thrills. Lean a ladder back chair on a windowsill and look out at the stars. He must have got it up in Michigan. He and his brothers were picking them. When he moved to Gary, he took it with him, that Gibson Hummingbird guitar. And oh, how that guitar would ring. Dad would close his eyes and sing. Silver-haired daddy would always bring a tear to his eye. I was all of 5 years old, my brother Don and a kid down the road. We just did what we was told, to get outside and play. Someone wrapped it in a coat and we took it to the swamp just to see if it'd float. But a hummingbird is not a boat, and it sank straight away. When he got home, that's when he heard what we'd done to that hummingbird. And he looked at me, never said a word, just went out back to sea. And there it was in all its mess, with the cattails and the red wing nests. And there he laid it down to rest for all eternity. Guitar and a brother or two, and underneath a Kentucky moon, giving back his childhood dream. It won't make up for 32 years, and it won't dry up a swamp of tears. But it's better than a case of beer and a fifth. Thank you. Thank you so much. So the other thing I want to illustrate and underline, and I did mention some of the mega Kentuckians like Travis and Skaggs and all that, but the other part about Kentucky are the unsung heroes like my dad, Wayne Scott. So that's part of Kentucky too, by the way. It's not just all stargazing style stuff. It's also the folks who just did it because they had to, they loved it. So no one could have loved music more than my own father, so which is where I got my music, and especially a sensibility of songwriting came from him. So for my dad, Wayne Scott, thank you all very much.